Hello, everybody. Welcome back to another movie commentary. Today, we are going to be watching Dinosaur. I'm Stacy.
And I'm Meg.
And I'm so excited. I love this movie.
So, last time I watched this movie was earlier this year. I don't know, when's the last time you watched it?
Not for a while. I've been listening to the soundtrack a lot recently.
Oh, it's such a good soundtrack. So this is a movie I cherished as a child because I was the resident dinosaur nerd at my of my friends at my school, what have you. And to this day, I still am a bit of a dinosaur nerd. Granted, I don't remember all of the knowledge I gained when I was a child. There's a lot of knowledge. Dinosaurs that I had that I don't have anymore because of memory loss.
Oh no.
Not like amnesia and memory loss. It's just I'm getting older and my memory isn't as good as it was.
Getting older? I'm older than you.
I have a bad memory. Anyways, point being is that so I actually have a fun memory of this movie. So when I was a wee child, my dad went on a lot of business trips, and so one time we went on one of his business trips to Hawaii, and I brought some movies with me to watch, and one of the movies I brought was DVD release of The Aristocats, and so I always liked watching the trailers on the DVD before I actually watched the movie, and I'll always remember that DVD had two trailers that I'll always remember, and it was Atlantis, The Lost Empire, and Dinosaur, and I'll always remember, and that trailer is what wanted me to actually get the movie and watch it for myself. Then I bought it, and I watched it, and I loved it, and then I found out that some people didn't like it, so I rewatched it again and said, those people are fucking idiots, because this movie is still really good.
For it being a movie that came out in 2000, I think the animation holds up extremely well.
Oh my god, it looks amazing.
It does. It's gorgeous.
It looks so good. We've had animated movies in the past decade that look worse than that movie. Let's just think about that for a second. Actually, did you know that all the backgrounds are live action in that movie?
Yeah. And the scene with the meteor, the first meteor coming down, it was shot on a mini-scale model, and then they just had a bunch of explosive, like, mini-explosives, and then they just blew it up to fit the screen. So technically, it's real explosions.
I actually didn't know that. That's really interesting.
Yeah. They built a whole mini-scale of the island, and then they just blew it up, and then put Aladar and all the lemurs on there.
There's also a ride based off this movie.
Anyways, the movie.
Yeah, we would like to apologize for probably 10 minutes of rambling about Disney parks.
So we are going to get started with Dinosaur. If you would like to see our full-length commentary, that will be on Patreon. The link will be in the description. And let's jump into it. I already know through the whole thing I'm going to be talking about the music.
Oh, God, the music and the animation. Visually speaking, this movie is just... It's weird because I think people keep saying that, like, the thing that ruins the movie is that they talk. But people are saying it like, oh, they talk through, like, the whole way. I remember rewatching and I'm like, they don't talk as often, I think, as people say they do. Like, yeah, they talk, but it's like, there is a lot of moments of just silence and expressions, and I feel like people just don't appreciate those moments. I feel like the moment people hear that they talk and they sometimes say a stupid 2000s joke, that's all people remember, and they don't think about the actual good parts of this movie, because there are really good parts of this movie!
Oh yes, mama.
Oh, I love that shot so much.
Me too!
It's such a cool shot!
And I think it was the director who talked about this. It was somebody who said that they didn't want to have the quote-unquote villain to be a T-Rex because they thought the T-Rex was getting enough villainous movies.
Yeah.
So they went with a Carnotaur, which I love. I love new dinosaurs.
Yeah, you know, I'm really happy about that too, because Jurassic Park, I feel, has basically stapled the idea of velociraptors and T-Rexes being the big bad dinosaurs. But there are multiple carnivorous dinosaurs that were dangerous and had a huge threat against herbivores. I like the fact that this movie wanted to kind of focus on different dinosaurs and wanted to kind of give like this sort of equal balance to all these different types of dinosaurs. I also love the fact that the Carnotaurs don't talk. It's like they seem so much more menacing and meticulous when they just don't speak. I will find my way. I will go the distance. I don't care how far. Someday I'll be strong.
And every mile will be worth my while. Oh, here it comes. I love this whole sequence.
God, this sequence is fantastic. It's so beautiful. But, like, the way it starts, like, so beautiful, but just kind of has a sense of suspension to it, and then it just kind of goes right into the action. It's so amazing.
See, look at this good foreshadowing. You have a little bit of ominous music in the background. You have the birds flying far away.
Frozen.
I also like how they designed the raptors for this.
Oh yeah, same. They could have very easily just done the Jurassic Park design, because that's a very famous velociraptor design. Again, I really appreciate how this film didn't want to kind of depart itself from Jurassic Park, when a lot of dinosaur movies were kind of attached to it, because that was just what was super popular. Hell, even Jurassic Park didn't really know how to detach itself from itself in the later movie.
Aren't these what raptors more look like? Because they're actually not that big as they show in Jurassic Park. They're actually smaller.
Yeah. They did eventually find a velociraptor. I don't remember where. They did eventually find a velociraptor that was around 8 feet tall.
Stay out of my way! You heard, Krong? Move it!
I hate Krong. He's such a dick.
He is.
Ugh, I do not like him.
And the one dinosaur that just walked by, Bruton, I couldn't say his name properly when I was a kid. I called him Crouton. Like the things in the salad.
We'll rest here for the night. Go ahead, Bruton.
Crouton.
We have now dubbed his name Crouton.
Better to keep our heads down with this bunch than get them bitten off by those things.
Well, you just consider yourself lucky. That's all that's following us.
More foreshadowing!
I love this montage. And I also love the animation. Just, I love how you can tell that they're all just in agony from this heat and this dry weather. And I love how you can even tell that the scales on them are super dry and crispy, and just, you know, it's like, it's so clear that they haven't had water in so long.
Okay, let's call the one, the bigger one, is a female in my headcanon. Let's call her Sally. What do you want the male to be called?
We'll call him Don.
Don, okay. Sally and Don.
Emma, please. The herd won't wait. We must carry on.
Can we appreciate how Baleen is a British longneck?
Everyone else is American, but Bailey,
she gotta be British. This is all during Pangea time, right? So maybe this Bailey, type of long neck is found in Britain, and she just made her way across.
If you want to go with that theory, sure.
Yeah.
Let's get out of here.
Good on Sally. I'm sure she was hungry.
Actually, what are these? I mean, herbivores, you know, they're more in danger than carnivores, because, I mean, with carnivores, they can just feast off of those animals that have already died and stuff, but what if the herbivores got nothing? They only eat plants. There are no plants out here. It's the desert. There's nothing.
Yeah, they're probably all starving, huh?
Yeah. Like, what are you doing? You don't have food.
Hey, come on, knock it off. Let's work together here, huh? A little teamwork.
He has the natural qualities of a leader by helping two little kids try to get water.
He has natural qualities of a father figure.
He's a dad! I swear to God, if someone in the comments makes a fucking daddy joke, I'm going to lose my shit.
I'm gonna say Min is probably gonna do that.
Oh, you Min. For having pretty realistic designs, I am still pretty happy and also impressed that they still managed to make the dinosaurs, and just like all the characters in general, really, really expressive. I always think that that's always been Disney's strength, expression.
And then there's Lion King. This flat-faced, zero expression.
Which ironically has the same method, filming the backgrounds and using CGI figures and animals.
What went wrong?
Actually, why is a movie that came out in 2000 better written and more expressive than a movie that came out 6 months ago?
From the same company.
From the same company! The same company! What has become of Disney?
Sally, I found dinner! Sally, he's running!
It's okay, little ones.
I do like how she started to kind of develop away from Krong's method and more into Aladar's, in that nobody should be left behind. And that's why she like goes back for like these two little kids. I like the fact that they kind of show that.
And as the smoke clears, they found it. The promised land.
The Great Valley.
Yeah, that was it! I was trying to remember, like, what do they call them? Land Before Time?
I love that, of just the Carnotaur coming right around the corner.
Yeah. I might be wrong about this, and it might be another breed of carnivores. But I actually think that there is some facts around this defeat, in that I think it might not be Carnotaurus. I think it's Carnotaurus, but it might not be. If people are welcome to correct me if I'm wrong, but I do think Carnotaurus typically, they can do it by themselves, but they usually do it in packs. But the reason why is that they can't attack if they feel they are outnumbered or outstrength, and that's why it doesn't work. The Carnotaur basically kind of gets overpowered by the sheer number of them. Granted, if it was just Aladar and Neera, like, no, they wouldn't have stood a chance. Carnotaur would have probably really tried to put up a fight. But the numbers is what intimidated him or her enough to back off. And it's why she goes for Krong at the end, because that's a lone dinosaur that she can very easily take on.
Can we talk about how resilient Sally is? She can climb rocks, and she's taking on three iguanodons by herself, and they're having trouble until just the rocks give away, just so happen.
Yeah, like, this is what kind of saves them in the end. It's just because, like, that edge of the cliff could not hold her weight, but yeah, I mean, it did definitely look like that Aladar was about to bite the dust.
Oh, yeah.
And then they all went extinct. The end. People who think this movie is bad can suck it, because this movie's great. I don't know what anybody's talking about when they say that this isn't a good movie. They're all liars. Okay, alright, let me be a little objective. So in one regard, there is some dialogue that doesn't hold up super well, but I'm willing to forgive it because it was the early 2000s, and dialogue writing in the early 2000s wasn't spectacular, especially for kids and family movies. But I'm I defend this movie wholeheartedly because I feel like those lines are few and far between. There aren't a lot of them. The movie, for the most part, relies on music and facial expressions and animation and visuals to carry out the story, which is how visual storytelling should work. And I think it does really good. The pacing in this movie is phenomenal. Like, I do think the best part about this movie is the pacing. They let certain moments sit for the just right amount of time for you to fully comprehend them. It's not too long, not too short, it's just right. So the pacing in this movie, aside from the visuals, I feel is the best part. And also the facial expression, just God, the fact, the way the facial expression just kind of say everything without the characters really needing to say all that much, I think is incredible. Like, it's just, there's so much that doesn't need to be said that is said in a single expression, and it works so well. This movie does not have a ton of exposition to it. It really doesn't. A lot of the exposition is simply visual, and I think that's great. I don't watch a lot of movies that just has purely visual exposition, where there isn't a lot of dialogue exposition. And I think that's awesome. I feel like the only, like, real exposition that we're given is when we first meet the Herd, and we just kind of are explained that Kron's the leader, and Bruton's the co-leader, and Nira's the sister. And that's really it. That's kind of it. And Conotors are the devil. You know, it's like... And that's all you need to really understand the story. And I love that. I think that's great. Even then, I really feel like you don't even need that to understand. I feel like the visuals do well on its own, but it's just still really good. I don't have any real criticisms to it, because I don't think it's, you know, is it a little similar to the Prince of Egypt, Moses type story? Yeah, sure. But a lot of dinosaur movies were doing that day, especially animated dinosaur movies. So, but I'm not even that mad, you know, like, I feel like, you know, people are like, oh, ever since Land Before Time and that was so popular, all the dinosaurs talk now. But people are saying it like the dinosaurs talking is like, the, you know, like the worst thing ever, and it ruins the movie. It really doesn't. Like, cause there's not as much talking as people might think there is. There is talking, but there is a lot, but there's still this equal balance of just facial expression. It's just kind of telling you the story and how the characters feel, and I think that's really good. And I don't know, I love that. Yeah, I don't have a lot to say in regards to this movie, because I love it, and I just think it's really good.
Yeah, I'm the same. I don't really have any complaints about this movie. I don't know anything that's, to me, that anything that's wrong with it. I love the soundtrack. I love the animation. I like the characters. There's not one that I don't like or one that I wish was different or one I wish wasn't in there. Mm-hmm. It's just a really enjoyable movie, and it's fun. It's just a fun movie to watch.
Yeah, and I agree in terms of the characters, too. I think they did all the characters really well in this movie. I mean, Krang's an asshole, yes. But I do think it's interesting how, even till the end, they keep him that way. Like, he dies from his own stubbornness. Like, he made this fate. If he had just listened to Aladar, he would have probably survived. And I think that, and I like that they did that for him. I like the fact that, no, we're keeping him stubborn the whole way. And that is inevitably what causes his fate. You know, and I think it's also a good message, like, you know, sometimes caring about only yourself and not really thinking about others can ruin everything and make everyone die in the end. And I think that's actually a really interesting lesson in terms of the whole survival of the fittest type thing, because everyone learns the whole survival of the fittest mindset, you know, in their lives. And I think that this movie kind of has an interesting contradiction to it, that if you go too far with it, you might end up killing everyone, including yourself, in the end. And I think that that's a really interesting message. And I think that the way that the movie did that was really good. But yeah, I think all the characters are great. I really like Aladar. Nira, I think, is a little of a... First, you think she's going to be a little bit of a pointless love interest, and she does kind of start that way, but I like the fact that she kind of does grow into a bit of her own character throughout the movie, and I really like that. I like Brutus a lot. I like his arc in the film. Yeah, I like Baleen, and Ima. I think they're really awesome characters. I think they're a lot of fun. I like the lemurs, you know? It's like, I don't really have a character that I think should have been... Well, that one monkey who's... That one lemur whose name I can't remember.
Zinni?
The orange one. Zinni, yeah. I think maybe Zinni could have been cropped out, but I honestly, that's it. Like, I think everyone else is really good, and I think... And I, like I said, I love the fact that the Carnotaurs are silent characters, and I like the fact that I just like the Carnivores. The Carnivores in general are silent characters, and I think that's really good because I think if you had them talk, that would have really diminished their more animalistic like qualities to them, and I think it definitely would have made them a lot less intimidating. You know, by having them not talk, there's a much more intimidation factor. Like you said, that scene where that one carnivore just starts coming around the corner is such a good shot. And it just, you know, like, it's such an animalistic shot, too. It's definitely just, like, it's creeping on its prey, and it's so good.
I think also if they made the Carnotaurs be able to talk, that would also humanize them a bit more. I know they're not humans, they're dinosaurs, but they're talking English.
No,
so
I know exactly.
Bear with me. So if they were able to speak, and if the writers wanted to, they could give them motivation as to why they're hunting. You know, like maybe they have an egg somewhere that doesn't have food, something. And just having them be able to talk, you could relate to them more, which you're not supposed to. They're the bad guy. You're supposed to root for the hero. You're not really supposed to sympathize them with them too much, because then that will just take you away from the main characters. And plus, with them not talking, it makes them more of a monster. It makes you more scared because you don't know what they're thinking. They're mostly just running on instinct, and that instinct is, I see food, I'm going to attack, and I'm going to eat, kind of thing.
No, I agree with all of that. That's a perfect way of saying it. And it also, again, I think a great example, besides that ending scene, the scene in the cave. Like, I think, you know, like, they're just, you know, they're sneaking into this cave, and you just see the Carnotaur's eye looking around, spotting Aladar, and then it strikes. And I think, yeah, and just having them speak or talk in that scene would have ruined it, because that's the whole suspense of it. They're just silent and trying to find their food, and the heroes are trying to find a way to get out of there. It's literally like you're trying to get away from this animal that has no other thought than kill for food or for sport, but mostly for food, because they're starving too.
Yeah, they've been following this herd for days.
Yeah, no, for sure. Yeah, no, it's just, I don't, there's nothing else for me to say than shit. It's just, yeah, no, it's just a good movie. It's a good movie with good scenes and good animation and good music and good writing, and damn it, I just really like this movie. This is a good movie. This is not a movie that has gone worse with time.
No.
If anything, I think there's more to appreciate to it now. Especially, you know, with all of Disney's live-action reboots that have been coming out in the past few years, those Disney live-action remakes, I feel like they aren't going to test the time, because Dinosaur is officially 19 years old, and it's almost going to be 20 years old by next year. And I think it is still way better than any of these Disney live-action remakes that have come out. Any of them. I think it's such a great movie. And I think that just goes to show that, you know, I feel like people hate on that early 2000 phase of Disney way too much, because I think those movies hold up way better than live-action films that people are going to look back on in 10 or so years.
I remember mostly growing up with the 2000s movies. I was born in the 90s, but I don't remember the 90s that well. The Disney movies that came out in the 90s or the 2000s, I really liked. And also, just as a person who's not really romance orientated, that I like the fact that
Hashtag asexual pride.
Yes, agreed. Most of them don't really have to do with romance type things. Like, you have Brother Bear, and that's brotherly love. And then you have Emperor's New Groove, and that's friends love. And just other ones that that just steer away from that. And I like that personally.
Treasure Planet is the love between a father and a son.
Yeah, that too. It's refreshing to me, and I enjoy that more than just straight, I need to find my prince or I need to find my princess kind of thing.
For me, I grew up with the 90s films, but I also grew up with the early 2000s films. Like, those films were, to me, like, so nostalgic and ones that I hold very close to my heart. And I just love them so much. And also, so, next week.
I'm excited.
I am not. I don't like this movie that we're going to watch. So, a lot of people know that this is a movie I actively dislike. And a lot of people also know that I vent about this movie endlessly and talk about how much I don't like it. This is just the situation that I've put myself in. Because Stacy likes this movie.
I love this movie.
I hate this movie. I really hate this movie. I will say, my art teacher worked on this film, and I got to look at all of the behind-the-scenes process that he worked on, because he was, like, a main storyboarder animator on the project. And, oh my god, he even said that this movie was a mess to work on. The production of this movie was so crazy. And, like, there's a song in the movie that literally was added. It's, like, it's a famous song. It was added last minute. They were, like, halfway through the project, and they're like, okay, we decided to put a song here. So, it's just, it shows. This movie's so sloppily made, and it's just so badly written. And, oh my god, like, you know, it's just, like, at least Swan Princess, I feel, had some redeeming qualities to it. Also, this movie does low-key offend me, because the story this movie is based off of, I love two pieces, and one of my all-time favorite TV shows is based off of this story, and so seeing it done poorly makes me mad. So I also have a little bit of biased anger within me.
Yeah, this movie I adore. It's a part of my childhood since before I can remember. I had this on VHS, and I just watched it all the time. It is a weird and kooky movie. I still love it. Probably for nostalgic reasons. I'm sure it has its flaws. I'm still gonna love it. But we also did a trade-off, I will say. Meg is going to watch a movie that she doesn't like, and then I'm going to watch a movie that I don't like.
I mean, that is a fair trade-off. I am defeated because I hate this movie.
So yeah, that about does it for this commentary with Dinosaur. Again, if you would like to see the full length, you can on Patreon. Link is in the description. And we will see you guys next week. Bye.
Bye.